This is BBC Knowledge.
I think of myself as a jazz musician. That's how I started. At the age of 5, that's what I wanted to be. I'm now apparently a film director, but actually I'm still a jazz musician. So I think that still informs very much the way, philosophically, the way I approach filmmaking. I studied music in London for 3 years. And met a lot of musicians, started playing free jazz in London. That, in turn, introduced me to a bunch of sort of experimental theatre people called The People Show, who I then joined for 10 years. And then I formed my own company as a director, still doing experimental theatre work, but incorporating film. And then that just kind of organically led to the desire to make a film, which I did. I made a short 1-hour sort of feature-ish kind of film for Channel 4 called The House, and that in turn led to Stormy Monday.
Brendan, give this man a pound, would you? Go on. You just sold me a car.
Having arrived in Hollywood, being very pleased to be there because they seemed very pleased to have me, and I was being offered work, and I did, you know, Internal Affairs, which was critically very well received. I mean, I sort of made my mark with that film. I felt confident, I felt very secure, I felt I knew what I was doing, which is always very dangerous. And I am then embarked on a series of films, Liebestraum, which I think 10 people saw, Mr. Jones, which was really a disaster in terms of the politics of the film as well as what the film ended up. And then finally, Leaving Las Vegas, which was a whole turning point in my career. The period between Internal Affairs and Leaving Las Vegas was the most intense educational period as a filmmaker, because I learned so much about filmmaking and about the political structure of filmmaking and how studios work, the fact that no one will ever have the courage to support a filmmaker in case they get found out and it doesn't work. I then sort of woke up with a very strong resolve to go back to the way that I'd always worked before, which was much smaller, much more experimental, and much more based on no interference from above and an incredibly tight and collaborative relationship with my actors. I've become fascinated by the possibilities of the digital revolution and what you can do with digital cameras and with video as opposed to film. I became obsessed with the idea of real-time drama.
Jeff, man, how's it going, dude?
And I was on a train and I was doing what if you could do a whole film now with video cameras that where tape will run for 2 hours? What if you could shoot a whole film in one take? Now that would be boring from just one point of view, but if you could shoot from, say, 2 and then only 4 points of view at the same time, so you're watching a quadrant, the eye and the brain relationship would be so stimulated in a way that conventional cinema doesn't stimulate you, that the film would operate on a different level from that of a conventional narrative film, which is dominated by the editor.
What do you think it's...
It's a bit complicated right now.
What do you think it feels like?
It's going to be okay, so... It's going to be okay,
so... So, in my notebook, as an exercise, I started to write a story specifically for a 93-minute real-time drama, where you couldn't say, cut to 3 months later.
Myself, I feel younger, louder, like I don't always connect, like I don't ever connect, and
great thing about filmmaking is that it is this long organic process where you have to trust in the end result as being a fantasy in your mind. And then finally, of course, it does come together, and it's never what you thought it was going to be. And if you've done your job well, it's become something entirely different and much more interesting than you originally thought of.
Joining Mike Figgis's masterclass are Newton Adowaka, filmmaker, Catholic Couture, filmmaker, Jimo Toyin Salako, filmmaker, Leslie Felprin, critic and journalist, Ben Gibson, director, London International Film School, and Sandra Hebron, deputy director, London Film Festival.
Film and the medium of cinema is something that is still, in my mind, potentially the most interesting option for an artist in the 21st century. I want to talk to you all about how you feel about cinema, and particularly the cinema now, where we're at a turning point unlike, I think, any other point in cinema because of the digital revolution. And the ramifications of that revolution are fascinating because it covers not just the way you make films, but the way people see films and how we think about it as an idea.
Is this the start of a relationship with a digital camera for you? Do you see that?
It's like sugar or drugs or something like that. The brain gets very pleasantly addicted to sharp, well-focused images and attractive actors. I mean, all these things become part of the experience that we expect. That trend in cinema, to me, has gone right down the wrong freeway, in American terms, because it's become hip to be digital at the moment. People are not so obsessed with things being in focus all the time. And a sort of gritty realism has become very acceptable, which opens up all kinds of doors to other kinds of filmmakers who don't have the economic potential to buy that kind of technology, i.e. 35mm sharp focus, big budget filmmaking. And one of the things I really beef with about a lot of films now is the use of camera movement. To me, camera movement is entirely specific, and certain rules exist because of the psychological relationship we have between the brain and the eye. So a creeping camera coming up from behind someone, that's definitely look out, it's going to whack your head. With the invention of Steadicam and certain cranes that are everywhere now in every shot, someone gets up to go to the bathroom and you have a crane movement because obviously the director said, oh, blimey, I just can't wait to get on that crane, you know. And you're thinking, why is the camera flying through the air now? What is this telling us psychologically? And the answer is, oh, well, don't worry about it because I'm going to cut into that shot so quickly because I shot five cameras on this sequence. So you go, whoa, and then there's this shot, and then there's that shot. You don't have time to really think about why the camera's moving like that. And at a certain point, I thought, let's start, go back to basics. And let us say the camera is either on a tripod and very still, or it's handheld and it's going to just move with the actors in a way that feels natural. To me, the richest period in, say, relatively recent memory was the 60s when you see Cassavetes and you see the Nouvelle Vague and the kind of freshness of the way the camera is being used there and the low-budget aspect of it, too. And how it somehow makes the story more believable, less remote from an audience.
I'm interested in you coming from the theatre and coming from jazz, which are both places where the UK is maybe not the best place in the world to be an innovator. Was there a culture that you wanted to belong to? Were there people that you specifically related to who you thought you might make your community and your career with in making films in this country?
I actually, ironically, grew up in Africa till I was 8 and then went to the north of England. By the time I was a teenager, I never had felt that I belonged to any particular culture because I'd never been in a gang. I mean, I desperately wanted to. To be part of a group of other kids of the same age. So you're constantly outside that and you're developing skill for a filmmaker. You learn to watch groups of people very carefully. You develop these voyeuristic skills.
But so a film like Stormy Monday, I mean, was it a shock to try and work in what was the official British way to make a feature film?
I know all about you, Cosmo. I know about the legitimate business in New York. A not-so-legitimate business in New Orleans. Senate inquiry. I've done my homework, Mr. Cosmo. You have not done your homework.
You're right, Mr. Finney. That was foolish of me.
Maybe you thought it wasn't necessary, huh?
The thing is, because it was a low-budget film, relatively, although for me a huge amount of money suddenly and a huge number of people, so I was very intimidated physically, as any film director would be. The hardest thing when you first make a film is the fact that people look bored. And so you constantly think, well, maybe it's... obviously, it's a really boring film, because, you know, the grips are looking bored and they just want to have a cup of tea. And but you have this insane desire to please everybody, as if it was a little theatre piece, you know, and for them to clap in between takes and things, you know, going, terrific, Mike. The experience was very odd. You don't often have time to stop and think artistically about what you're doing, and you're going a lot of the time just on your instinct. And the one big advice I would give to anybody who's going to make a film is thinking, never, ever, ever allow anybody to talk you out of your instinct for a shot or for a moment or for an idea, because there will be 100 reasons not to do something you thought was strong, and never let anybody dissuade you from it, even though suddenly you're faced with the reality of it and there's a set and all that, and you think, oh my God, this is a totally stupid idea. It's probably not. You should try and just make it work.
When you moved to work in Hollywood, I'm interested to know whether the fact that you came from not a conventional film background, in a sense, made your path smoother or made it a kind of more difficult ride.
The interesting thing about Hollywood, the good thing about Hollywood, is that there's a refreshing lack of bias compared to the UK. Your entry credentials need only be, did you make an interesting film, or could you make an interesting film? Because could that make money? It's really great when you first arrive, because everyone wants to talk to you and everybody wants to be in business with you if potentially you can make a film that can work. The thing that was interesting about the Hollywood system for me was the degree to which the physicality of actors, crucially, the color of their skin and so on, was a non-negotiable factor almost. It just was a fact. When I did One Night Stand, I worked with a brilliant black actor, Wesley Snipes, and came up against very interesting, very subtle racial issues. The interesting thing about the film business is that it is not in the avant-garde of the race issue. It's actually, I think, in the rear guard. It's very conservative, it's very reactionary. And the way black actors and actresses are cast, I think, is interesting now, in the sense that, for example, you can be a judge, a doctor. All judges seem to be black actresses now on soaps and things. It seems to be just... That's all there is.
There's another thing about casting where you push certain actors, I'm thinking of, you know, Richard Gere, and whether you can trust him, what that sort of means for the experience of watching Internal Affairs.
She's very pretty, isn't she?
She's beautiful.
You want her?
I want her.
Mm-hmm.
Get another life.
I want her. Then I get another one.
I'm not looking for another.
That's good. Tell you what, Raymond.
What?
If you want to ask me any more questions about Van Stritch, take me down to Internal Affairs. Do it officially.
I don't need to ask anymore.
Good.
I got all my answers.
Thank you.
Because I'd done quite a long period in theatre and music before I got anywhere near films, so I'd been around the block several times in terms of drama, I naively just went into filmmaking with the idea that you read a character and then you try and surprise the audience in your casting. You don't give them the guy they think they're going to get, because that would be boring. And it was interesting with Richard Gere, because at that point, the studio wouldn't touch him. But I went ahead and I pushed and I pushed, and eventually, and of course afterwards, when he got all the accolades, his executives would literally take credit for putting him in the film, saying, you know, gosh, I fought so hard to get Richard in the movie because I've always respected him. And I thought the degree of hypocrisy that exists in Hollywood is almost charming.
Do you think a film like A Loss of Sexual Innocence would be able to be made in Hollywood? Because it seems to be across so many different boundaries, you know, so many different stories, and I love that film. I really like the experimentalness of it, and the casting, and the way how everything sort of merged. And I mean, how difficult would that type of film be?
Impossible.
To make?
Pretty much impossible. Yeah. I mean, at one point I almost got it made, and there was a wonderful lunch where two producers, who had certainly, we love the film, you know, it's wacky, it's out there, it's sexy. There is one very small technical issue, but I hardly want to trouble you with it, Mike, you know. I said, well, no, let's do it, you know. He said, well, it's just, listen, it's nothing. It's just, you know, you have Adam and Eve, and Adam is black and Eve is white. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, the South African distributor who's now running, you know, would like you to switch that round. This was only 6 years ago, 7 years ago. And that was my one attempt within the Hollywood system to raise finance for it. So after leaving Las Vegas with a bit of a higher profile, I just went around European sources and put the film together very, very cheaply. Is it okay to use stereotypes in films if you're making a point about stereotypes? For example, I was asked to make a film about Miles Davis. Now, I love Miles Davis, now I'm a trumpet player, but I felt uneasy about being asked to make maybe the only film about one of the most seminally important black musicians of the last century. And I had a very interesting conversation with Reggie that was doing the script. I said, how do you feel about it? And he said, I think if you make a good film about Miles, that's okay. And I said, but there are enough black filmmakers who could also make this interesting. What do you think?
I sort of think I could make a film about white characters. Mm-hmm. You know? So the actual film itself should be the test, but it's just a shame that the resources and the finances for black filmmakers is shallow.
Newton Adowaka is one of the few black filmmakers in Britain to have a distribution deal for his first feature film.
To get a film made, I think the fundamental thing that you need is belief.
Everybody clap your hands, hey.
Because it is not an easy process, and people will put you down, and people will... You have to know why you're doing what you're doing. I left the London International Film School 10 years ago, and I just spent 7 years after that, you know, chasing around the industry, trying to get people to take what I do, to take me seriously, to believe in me in a sense, and say, okay, well, I would like what you're doing, I want to support you. Here's some money, go off and do this, do a short film, whatever. But what I kept getting was, you know, meetings and, you know, interviews, and they liked what I was writing, but they didn't want to make what I was writing. I lost total faith in the industry, and I thought, it's not me, you know. There is a problem with the industry. I'm not going to spend another 7 years sitting around waiting for the industry to help me out. I have to help myself. Rage was picked up at the London Film Festival by Metrodome, and what they said was that, you know, they could release this in a minimum sort of theatrical release, or if we were interested in recutting it, that they would be looking more at a wider release. And of course that was very appealing, and we thought, wow, fantastic, you know, it'd be great to have like a general release of this film. But this for me was a bigger decision. I mean, you're talking about, there are certain things that you feel the film should reflect, and someone's saying, well, we don't think it would work in terms of our target audience. And suddenly you're now looking at marketing, you're talking to people that are sellers, you know, they're marketing people. You cannot talk to them about anything creative. I mean, they do not understand, they don't talk in those sort of terms.
Well, nice, I'm loving this. What? What are we doing? What are we doing? Come and meet these gold pots.
If I have to go back again and do a film like I did Rage, I'll do it again if I believe in the material, in the story I'm trying to tell. I would find a way of telling it.
God, I sound really angry. Good. I mean, it's interesting. You talk in there about them.
Mm.
They don't understand.
Mm.
They are distributors, they're salespeople, you know? And of course, it's all true. Most other art forms, you carefully surround yourself at little salons with people, you know, in coffee bars and things who kind of go, I've read your short story, man, it's really lovely. Mm. We find ourselves consistently in rooms with people who kind of go, we need more sex in it. And you very rarely get feedback from the people that you think you're making the film for. I know with films, like with Liebestraum, there's an earlier cut. I think it's stronger because there's more story there and there's some very useful information. But by the time the film was released, there was so much pressure to cut and cut and cut that just resisting that and letting something go out, which at least I felt represented the idea, was a major achievement in itself. And it's not like the shorter film
suddenly became a huge box office success either. You know, it's like it didn't change anything. It was just a shorter disaster than a longer disaster. So, the idea that you have to be strong enough to take the abuse or whatever it is, the negativity that you will inevitably get, that is the current system. I'm proposing that it's no longer necessary to have that, that we could have a more creative environment. Do we have to even bother with this system anymore? Surely if we've got just a decent digital projector, rented a room above a pub and call it a cinema, just say, this film premieres starting next week in Time Out, whatever, and it's going to run for 4 weeks. Get some reviews and not worry about getting 20 prints and all of it, just one print to start off with. My big hope is that that's what's going to happen next. I mean, that's what I'm going to try and do next.
You've interspersed your recent career with making feature films, fictional films, with making documentaries. What attracted you to kind of going back to documentary?
I was in the doldrums at a certain point when I was doing Mr. Jones and having this long battle, which gave me a lot of time to think about the kind of filmmaking that I admired and wanted to be part of, which in one aspect turned into Leaving Las Vegas. I was aware of the fact as a musician that although documentaries and art documentaries are made all the time, I never particularly liked any of them. And I felt that documentaries in a way should excite you to the extent that you want to go and find out more about the subject, the person, whatever it is. So this led to me doing a documentary where I did one on fashion with Vivienne Westwood, one on Billy Forsyth, contemporary dance, and my favorite one, which is the one on flamenco, just because I'd seen flamenco and I loved the way the women worked. I became sort of liberated by the experience, and it really helped the way I approached feature filmmaking. And again, it was to do with the fact that technically cameras were becoming available, which you could put in your bag and just whip out and just hold, and you weren't like having a big neon sign saying, I'm a documentary filmmaker.
Did that feed in particularly to Time Code, where, you know, it's kind of wonderful that the actors seem to lead the action. Camera follows them, so it's almost...
You're able to finally just to say to the camera people, you know, just you, there's no team, just follow what's going on. There will be no preset limitation on the actors. That's what I loved about it, to say to an actor, you've got a 93-minute improv take, and you can do or can go anywhere you like.
Do you think that if you weren't Mike Figgis, that something as kind of experimental and brave as Time Code 2000 would have got the distribution that it's had?
I've always had immense luck, but I would define luck as being the ability to be in the right place at the right time. It so happened that Sony Picture Corporation were interested in spending a little bit of money on a digital film so they could say that as a studio they had participated in the digital revolution. The budget was between $3 and $4 million, which is expensive for what the film is, but nothing for a studio film. I think you're right in answer to your question. It helped to have Leaving Las Vegas made the difference. You know, it gives me an entry card.
Shooting People is a new breed of film organization which uses technology to allow members to help each other.
Shooting People is a dynamic online film community that is bringing together the film community, independent film community, on a daily basis to sell scripts, crew up films, exchange information, and in so doing is helping to drive forward the creation and distribution of indie filmmaking throughout the UK. Jess and I set it up in November 1998, and we'd just come off the back of making our first film. And during that time, we're kind of really aware of the limitations of trying to pull together crews and trying to get information on funding and finding sound men and all the rest of it. So we launched with about 60 filmmakers at that stage, people, mates that we knew that were making films.
And it grew largely through word of mouth on film sets and things, people passing on, you know, to each other the URL to go and join up. And it's grown to just over 7,000 filmmakers today, and growing by about 100, 150 filmmakers a week.
So the way it works is every morning you get a daily email if you subscribe, which is for free. and you get this daily email and it comes in and it's full of questions and answers sent in from all the membership. So it's people wanting to crew up their productions, sell their scripts, find a location, ask a query about copyright.
Without leaving home, by just sitting at your desk, you're immediately connected to 7,000 other people who know everything you need to know, who've got everything you need to get, and who've got all the skills that you need to connect to.
The film I'm making, entitled The Eddie Effect, which is a 90-minute feature being shot on DV and on a budget of £8,000, which we raised ourselves, is being shown on the BT website, Film Showcase website. Via shooting people, I've got a male lead, one of the main female characters, and a lighting engineer. Shooting people, I think, is a fantastic idea. You know, it's an email and a phone call, and you've got somebody sorted out. For somebody in my position, with not much time and not much money, it's ideal, to be honest.
I mean, it does not cost you much now to be able to make a film. DV is cheap. It can be, if you apply, you know, proper lighting and all the rest of it, and apply a filmic discipline, you can make really top quality films. But also, I think importantly and crucially, critically, is that new technology, a lot of it is about creating communities. And that is absolutely what Shooting People is trying to do. And in so doing, is able to really stimulate and drive forward independent filmmaking across the UK.
Who funds Shooting People?
It was just set up by us talking to mates, getting a couple of computers together, free software, and running the whole thing for free, and favours.
What's in it for you?
We set it up originally because it was something that I felt we really needed. You know, we'd made the first film, and actually our first effort was really shambolic.
And do you feel, from your point of view, your generation and so on, that it's something that has the strength to take on the larger organisations within the film business?
I think everyone at the moment is at a stage where they think, yep, we can go out and we can do it. But the fear is in the distribution. I don't know what we can do about that, whether we wait for broadband and see if actually creating our own channels is the way forward. But at the end of the day, we want people to see the stuff we're making.
Even if you look at what's happening in London, you know, dotted around there are all these little pockets and places where people are showing digital work in a whole series of contexts that even 5 years ago would have seemed quite extraordinary.
The kind of thing that Shooting People is doing is, for the moment, relatively local, but its potential is much, much broader. The great thing about the technology is that you can build the parallel structures which are actually rather powerful in terms of drawing in huge numbers of people. It's not necessarily millions of audiences, but it might be lots of very small theatres
and lots
of places.
I think the next 3 years is fantastic for a very simple reason, is that until broadband quality becomes available, what is acceptable in the short term is very low res storytelling, which means that there is actually a technical, justifiable reason to make impressionistic cinema. Now, to me, that's fantastic, because the kind of cinema that I always loved was deeply impressionistic, not representational, you know, had a poetic quality to it, and where the disintegration of the image was something that was thought of as being valid and exciting. Given a situation where you have virtually no equipment, and, you know, the camera quality is not very good, if that were just the rule of the day, beautiful cinema would still emerge within that limitation.